Thank you very much. You'll be pleased to know that actually we're not representing the North. Worcestershire, which of course, as you know, is in the West Midlands. So, my name's Sophie Price. I'm Reconnections Manager at Age UK Herefordshire and Worcestershire. And so here to let you know all about Reconnections, which is led by Age UK Herefordshire and Worcestershire, an innovative pilot project in Worcestershire to help overcome loneliness and isolation. I really wanted to show you the sort of practical and operational side of what we're doing in our programme to overcome loneliness. And I wasn't going to mention it, but I can't help it. This chap on the screen is called Alf. He's one of our clients. I can't help but rave on about him. He's fantastic. He's an example of somebody who actually was bereaved, went to live with his son and grandchildren. So you could say, well, he can't be lonely then because he's living with his family. But actually for 10 years, he was lonely because, you know, the grandkids are on their gadgets. He has a lovely family, but he didn't feel a part of their world. So he found Reconnections. We reintroduced him to some groups, some harmonica groups, recorder groups that he liked to play with. And now he's actually also volunteering for us as well. So just an example there already of the work that we're doing in Worcestershire. So we're going to give you a service overview. I'm going to flick through that until it's all on the screen, and then I'm going to talk through it. Hopefully I'm not going to press too many buttons. Right. Okay, so we are actually a social impact bond. So Reconnections is delivered through a social impact bond. Worcestershire County Council and the three clinical commissioning groups will pay outcomes for older people to overcome loneliness. So social impact bonds are payment by results programmes. Through a social impact bond, social investors cover the upfront costs for social enterprises and charities to deliver new and exciting programmes to address the needs of vulnerable groups. And the social investors for Reconnections programme are Nesta and the Care and Wellbeing Fund. Lead partner, as I said, is Age UK Herefordshire and Worcestershire. The investors in the Reconnection Social Impact Bond only receive a return on their investment if the programme achieves positive outcomes, which in this case is a reduction in loneliness. And the Reconnections Social Impact Bond is managed by Social Finance. I'm just going to flick through this. This is obviously a map of Worcestershire. And I'm just bringing up our partners, because Reconnections is a service that's implemented countywide in Worcestershire, and we have six delivery partners and one specialist delivery partner, which is Deaf Direct, working with Deaf and Hard of Hearing. So this is just bringing up the names of our partners who cover each area of the county. And we're also bringing up there our investors and some of our partners. It's going to look quite messy. Am I going to? I've clicked too far. I knew I'd do it. Right, there we go. Sorry, that looks quite busy now. But just to show you that, as I said, Reconnections is funded by Care and Wellbeing Fund and Nesta, and we receive payments from the County Council, the CCGs, and also Big Lottery Fund. So it's just interesting to note that we're working with investors, commissioners, development partners, and also academics, PSSRU and the LSE. So this brings with it its advantages and also its complications, but mainly advantages. So I wanted to show you a client journey of how Reconnections works. So this is an example of a client journey from engagement and referral through to independence. So I'm going to give you an example here. This is Mrs. Smith, a widow with decreasing mobility and a growing sense of loneliness and isolation. She's referred to her Reconnections by her GP, who noticed her low mood and has continued 2 years since her husband passed away. So the GP completes a referral form and sends it to Reconnections. So Mrs. Smith is contacted by our triage team, as we call them, Age UK, who explain the programme, complete the UCLA questionnaire over the phone, check for eligibility, and passes the details to one of our seven delivery partners. So a delivery partner, one of their assessment officers will go and actually visit Mrs. Smith and take her through a guided conversation, identify some of the causes of loneliness and ways in which she would like to connect with people, places and activities. A volunteer is then matched to Mrs. Smith, who encourages and accompanies her to attend, for example, a singing group. When she's nervous about the first step, the volunteer supports her with mindfulness strategies. Mrs. Smith attends the singing class for 3 to 6 months, and if she misses a session, the volunteer will call and offer her support. She's then linked with others from the group who start to meet socially. She's phoned for the 6-month evaluation, as we work with our clients for 6 to 9 months. And the evaluation is taken again, the UCLA score is taken again at that 6 to 9 month point, and that's where we see the difference in the score and whether or not the loneliness has come down. Mrs. Smith now meets new friends for coffee on a weekly basis. She starts an exercise class at the community centre, and she now volunteers herself with Reconnection. So that's just an example of a client's journey in an ideal world, as how it happens. At the very bottom, I don't know if you can see that, but that's just a little photograph of some of our delivery partners. As I said, we've got 7 delivery partners who cover the whole of the county, each have a geographical area. Just a brief mention of eligibility. We do have eligibility criteria. Clients must be over 50, living within Worcester County Council area. They must not have had a dementia diagnosis, and not in receipt of funded social care, not in residential care, and they must score over 5 in the UCLA score. So that's just to give you an example of our eligibility criteria. So, as I said, we are a pilot project. We're learning and making changes as we go through this programme, which is all very exciting. And we have made some changes as we're going along, so I'm just going to tell you about some of those changes. So we actually launched in August 2015. At the very start, we found the programme involved too much process and paperwork. Huge demands on our delivery partners, who are small voluntary sector organisations. We were expecting a lot from them. You know, we do a lot of monitoring. Everything, you know, is monitored and put into our software system. So they felt overwhelmed by this. So as a result, the service has evolved and we've made positive changes. One of the things we also found at the start was a lack of referrals. I think we thought we'd get a huge amount of referrals from GPs, for example. Not as easy as we thought. So yeah, a lack of referrals and also volunteers right across the area. And we needed to take action on that. So increase improvement and communication, we held what we call roadshows, an outdoor lounge. We've targeted each area of the county individually. And one of the things we do is we take a gazebo, we take sofas, we take tea and coffee and cakes, and we set up what you might call a living room in a high street. And this is what we're doing all around the county at the moment. It's one of the things to increase referrals and increase volunteering, and that's working quite well. It has led to an increase. We've increased our promotion and talks, presentations, and we're also working with Worcester County Council to target Worcester City with our promotion. Interesting again to note also, we have a much higher level of loneliness than we could have expected, and we couldn't have predicted this. And with that comes chronic loneliness, with that health problems, including anxiety and depression. So we have a lot of people on our service who are at that top end of the loneliness scale. We saw the need for greater flexibility in the service, so we introduced call-in time as an extra and interim support, the national call-in time. We introduced shorter, more intensive periods of support, plus an extended service, increasing the time we support clients from 6 months to 9 months. We were supporting people for just 6 months initially, but we found that for some that wasn't enough, so we've increased it to 9 months. And also with the UCLA score, we reduced the eligibility from a 7 to a 5. Initially, we were only taking people who scored a 7 and above, and we realised we were losing people who perhaps were actually lonely, so we reduced that to a 5. Service delivery was also inconsistent due to a lack of monitoring or actions or understanding of the quality of the service that was needed. For example, a client who had requested to be taken out was perhaps only receiving phone calls. It's not enough. So it was necessary to share best practice across our delivery partners. We found we needed to be one big team rather than them and us, which we were finding. So we altered our delivery partner meetings. We have one-to-one meetings with the partners each month. Our Reconnections officers, our teams, took on a Reconnection coordinator role, providing support and advice to the delivery partners, but not duplicating their work. We introduced new KPIs and a rating scale. So in addition to the UCLA scale, we also introduced a rating scale. When we asked at the 6 month point the UCLA questions, we also asked, how do you rate our service between a 1 and a 10? So that's quite interesting, because it could be that their score is perhaps the same as it was before, but they score as a 10. Go figure. So we reduced the monitoring and paperwork and altered our delivery partner contracts. We also have a Facebook forum for volunteers as well. And finally, funding. We don't pay our delivery partners a huge amount. We found the funding wasn't aligned with the frontline delivery, and we needed to give the delivery partners more money and better control, so we introduced a structured monthly payment for them. And also we gave them more power in that we allowed them to do their own assessments, their face-to-face assessments. We were doing that as a team previously. So quite a lot of changes have been made, all for the better. So, I've already mentioned the key components of what actually changed, but I think the main thing to mention here is preparation of client exit. So volunteers and delivery partners now know to plan ahead to help decide which organisations and activities to refer a client onto at the 6 to 9 month point, because it can be. We don't want dependence on our volunteers of the clients, but they may become dependent. So it's very important to prepare that client that actually this isn't long-term support, it's 6 to 9 months. So at around about the 4 month point, the volunteer, you know, needs to start thinking about what that client needs and start putting that into place. The delivery partners are also required to complete an exit questionnaire so that our triage team back at base know who has been supporting the client and what activities they've been doing, so that when they phone at the 6 month evaluation point, they can discuss what the client's been doing, the name of the volunteer, and give that personal touch and recognition over the phone. And again, that might lead to a better score, a better rate of service. If the triage team have no details to hand, sometimes the clients deny all knowledge of this having received the service. They might say, well, I don't know what Reconnections is, even though they've been receiving a service for 6 months. They might say, well, I don't have a volunteer. But if we say, actually, you know Barry, he takes you down to the singing group. Oh, yes, I know Barry. That's the volunteer. So if we've got that information, it really helps. And all delivery partners also have a manual on CharityLog, which is the system that we use, with detailed steps on what they need to input, so we get all that information from them. Also, briefly, just to add, volunteering. Reconnections team, we actually also provide training. Our central team at Age UK were providing that previously, but we're doing that ourselves now. We're using social media, we're using SurveyMonkey applications so that it makes it quicker for volunteers to apply to become a volunteer. We are providing monthly training. It's actually hooking in volunteers at a much quicker rate than traditionally. And actually, over January, our average age range of volunteers has been around about 45, age 45, which is fantastic. So, is there something missing on there? Okay, measuring loneliness. So to understand what success looks like, we needed to obviously measure the loneliness of the participants during and after the programme, as we've said. It needed to be robust and rigorous, auditable and appropriate for service delivery, which of course the UCLA scale is. So, UCLA scale is obviously the most commonly used metrics of loneliness. It's a short scale consisting for us of 4 questions, and therefore it's possible to administer as part of service delivery. It's been used in a large number of studies and interventions, and also used in the English Longitudinal Study of Ageing, and survey results can therefore be benchmarked against national comparators. There's evidence from 2 studies of up to 0.78 reduction in loneliness points for clients in the programmes using the UCLA scale. In particular, the fact that the 4-item scale had been used in 2 studies done over the phone was particularly important to our investors. So those are the 4 questions we use. The additional question there is how often do you feel in tune with the people around you? So that's the UCL scale, and that's the 4 questions that we use. Our commissioners wanted us to focus on clients who are more lonely. So to assess this, we use the UCLA scale, and as I said, we use it again at the 6 to 9 point and then at the 18 month point to gauge loneliness levels. So score is calculated between 4 and 12. So as I said, we brought down the eligibility to 5. So the interview takes place primarily over the phone with our triage team. They need to make sure that the questions are understood properly, that the interviewee feels comfortable to share their answers, and that the overall score seems in line with the actual loneliness of the person. but actually that's easier said than done. I think this scale was not particularly introduced to be used over the phone. So our triage team are actually very highly skilled in doing this. It's very, very difficult to ask these questions over the phone. To build that relationship is very, very tricky. But they are highly skilled, and they do make clients feel confident to answer over the phone. Now, sometimes we do this face-to-face. You know, we have clients who are hard of hearing or who just very much feel the need to have somebody with them, and we will go out and do the face-to-face triage and then assessment all in one go. There aren't many that score a 4, but if they do, then we ask them if they'd like to volunteer for us. And some do. A lot of people go on to volunteer for us anyway at the end of the, you know, at the system, but why not? as I said, we do have a very high level of people scoring between a 10 and a 12. I think it's something around about 40%, which we could never have predicted. I'm looking at Marathi there thinking, oh gosh, is it 40? It's about 40. Don't quote me necessarily on that, but it's a very, very high level. We also use a health questionnaire. I know there was a question earlier on about assessing people's use of the health service. Well, actually, we do that. So in addition to our assessment forms, we use a health questionnaire as well to gauge healthcare usage. One of the questions, for example, is how many times has a client visited the GP in the last 3 months? So we will ask that again at the 6 month point. So again, this is helping us to gauge whether or not our interventions have helped and whether or not we're reducing the cost to the health services. The form is quite complex. We're filling this in for the LSE in order to track health service usage, but it's quite confusing for our client group. You know, lonely elderly people, the trade-off between using a robust methodology to obtain quality data and maintaining engagement and not deterring clients and staff by using an overly complicated process is quite tricky. So we're trying to find a balance there. The questionnaire is not lengthy itself, but there are a lot of consents that go with it, so it's quite tricky. So we're looking at the collection method for this. Who's the best to collect this? Should it be the volunteer? Should it be the LSE? Should it be done by post? So we have questions over the best method and most successful way in order to get these completed. And again, at the 6 month point, this is something that we are in the process of refining at the moment. I think that's me, and I'm gonna hand over to Marie-Elfie next. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Marie-Elfie. I work in social finance. I'm an analyst there. And I'm in charge of everything around data collection, analysis, and then presenting it to the relevant people. You are the relevant people today. most of the time, I work with our board of the Reconnection Social Impact Bomb, the delivery partners, and of course the central team. So first, I thought it'd be very helpful for you, for me to give you an overview of the key figures that we currently can define the Reconnections program. So far we've had a bit more than 1,000 referrals. Out of them, 533 people actually became participants, so it's around 50% conversion rate, that's how we call it, referrals turned into participants. Half of the people who did not become participants either were ineligible or declined the services, stating that they didn't need it either before or after triage. So these participants, we have an average age of 80 years old and mostly women. 71% of our participants are female. And so far, as of December 2016, we've had, actually it's not 234, it's 200 trap, I don't know what I wrote that. But 200 successful exits, successful meaning people that finished and completed the 6 months of service, 6 or 9 months of service, and for people for who we've been able to collect a second UCLA score. So from these 200 successful exits, we've had 246 loneliness points. As was mentioned earlier, on the SIB program, we are paid on these loneliness decrease points. So that equates to around £100,000 pounds of outcome payments that we received so far. And on average, people, participants coming, taking part of the service had a loneliness decrease of 1.23 points. So this number is net out. So if, for example, we score two people, one of them had a loneliness decrease of 3 points, and the other person had a loneliness increase of 2 points, we'll only declare 1 point here. So we are basically netting out any loneliness increase as well. We use the data that we collect to discuss the performance of the service with our board. So gonna now give you a quick overview of the levers that we use to think about the performance of the service, how to improve it. So we have three main things that we look at. We look at the number of people starting, so the starts. We also look at the collection rate at 6 months, and of course the service quality and the outcomes, so the loneliness points decrease. So this is a graph that shows you where our referrals come from. So quite interesting, we were betting a lot on GPs, and when you're looking at that, they're not very very important, like they're not the best source of referrals for us. And it's something that was actually came as a surprise. But we also look at the conversion rate of the referrals, depending on the type of referrer. And it's really interesting to see that charities, so referrals coming from charities and self-referrals, were the best referrals, so the ones leading to the most participants. So that we used also in service delivery to maybe better target the people we were talking to. So then I said about the collection rate, so it's the second lever that we're looking at. How many people are we able to interview a second time to get the UCLA score? So that's the collection rate for December. And every month we look at how many people we've been able to score a second time and the reasons why we're not able to score, the people we're not able to score. It's actually quite interesting to see. So overall, since the beginning of the service, we are at around 61% of collection rate. So we've been able to get in touch with 61% of our participants after 6 months, which actually we had, we were much more optimistic than that at the beginning. We were hoping to get in touch at around 80 to 90% of the people. Actually, there's a lot of plans got terminated, sadly, because people die or move away, or there's lots of reason why we can't terminate a plan. People also decline the service. Some people are unable to understand the question or became ineligible during the service delivery, as in they entered a care home or they moved away from Worcestershire. So many reasons actually why we cannot get in touch with these people in the end. So this is an important lever that we're using to increase the performance of the service. And as Sophie mentioned earlier, the exit interview and the exit preparation played a huge part in improving this indicator. And then lastly, the last lever that we look at, service quality. So this shows for each month since March 2016, when the first 6 month evaluation happened. This shows the average loneliness decrease and the average satisfaction score. So the bar is the satisfaction score and the loneliness decrease is the orange dot. So it's really interesting, as also Sophie mentioned earlier, to see that there's actually no real correlation between the satisfaction and the loneliness decrease. We ran a regression and there was nothing to see there. Some people are very happy with the service, actually had a good time, but they can stay very lonely still. And that's also something that we've seen during the service so far. The time when you actually get the second score might define a lot of the score. And if, for example, you just called somebody who left a very fun and interesting activity and ends up all by themselves at home, they feel suddenly very lonely, even if they would say that they had a great time. We are around now at around 7 to 8 average satisfaction score for the service, which is quite good. I mean, we've done a very good December month. Congratulations. But yeah, it's hard to see any pattern or any trends in this, as of course every person is completely different. So that's how we use the data and at the board level with our investors and our directors. Now I'm going to show you a bit more how we use data in the service delivery and with the front staff. So we introduce delivery partner packs that we discuss with the delivery partners every month. So these are very particular measures of what is happening in the service. Try to help the delivery of the service and the staff as much as we can. So it shows the number of activities that actually happen during the month, the kind of activities. So you have volunteering, coffee, informal activities, sports, so different things. We also look at the volumes and try to help them predict the different flows of participants coming in. So if we had, let's say, 8 people referred in their district last month, we say, oh, you might have actually 8 people next month. So we try to help them and really use it on a constant basis to help them organize themselves more as well. We also reviewed all the key performance indicators to make them very operational. So it looks at staff. So what's the caseload per volunteer? Are you sure you have enough volunteers to take care of your clients? Then we also have service delivery. So how many people have you actually engaged with during the month? And that's how we discuss, well, most of the time, this is how Sophie discussed with the delivery partner to really drive and improve performance on the ground. And then we also use data to map our clients and find out where they are. This has actually been the case in Malvern, where they used our data to better organize the health services. I don't know the details of that, but that's really something that we want to use further, especially knowing that it's a very rural area, and we've identified that mobility and transport is a real issue, and knowing where the people are and seeing how we can ease them going around is going to be very important for us and them. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit more about the key learnings we had, especially in terms of data collection in the program. So that was I was a bit of the nobody liked me at the beginning because I was there. I was coming and said, oh, I want all this data from you, and I know, and I understood them as we were working together. I mean, data collection here is not the essential thing. What's essential is that people actually are less lonely. So we didn't want to, you know, create a data burden that prevents people from doing their job well. Because there's so many things that we can look at, there's so many things that we can actually record, the age demographic stuff, yes, but there's also triggers of loneliness, types of activity, time spent, so there's so many things really. But we decided to focus on what's really important, the essential, and really focus on that so that people can actually like me a bit more there. That's the only. And also, as Sophie said, we understood that we had to provide the right support because, I mean, also computer literacy is not a very important skill when you're working in Worcestershire with older, lonely people. And we realized that some things that were completely obvious for us were not obvious on the ground. So we build a manual to help with all the recording of the data. It seems quite basic, but it's really important because also it, you know, just puts a foundation, creates a foundation, and everybody can look at it and say, oh, this is what I need to do. And now it's clear and I understand. So have a right level and have something, you know, concrete that can actually be referred to. We also try to make data useful to the frontline staff. So it's not just to control you, it's also to help you. So for each data point that was collected, we try to give and provide a justification. So we want to know that because it helps us knowing that and that. And actually knowing that will help you doing that. So always try to make it useful. So that was used also in the delivery partner packs. So it's not just something that is used at the board level or during conferences, but actually something that people in the on the ground use and know. And then also using the right tools. So so we're a pilot and we didn't have any purpose-built management information system. But if we could do it in an ideal world, I guess we'd say the easiest, the best, the better, the best. We have the tool has to be very user-friendly and simple, and purpose-built if possible. So it's really focused on what you're looking at, and there's no other distraction. Also, in terms of working with academics and researcher, there's things around safe, secure information, remote access, randomization, that are also key features that need to be present in the tool to do that the best way. To finish, so this is more of an open-ended question, reflection, thinking about how has we collect so much data. We already have 500 participants. It's going to get bigger. So it's a significant amount of people. And it's also, I mean, we collect data monthly, which is quite, I mean, I think it's a good frequency. How can we participate in research? How can we use all this data to I think it's something also that you mentioned in your presentation earlier. How can we really foster all this thing, this richness? So what we think first is maybe we can provide baselines. The 60% collection rate so far could be a good baseline, for example. We also can provide maybe first hypothesis. So something that we've seen is that people with a higher loneliness score, so between 10 and 12, tend to have much better outcomes. So on average, they have a loneliness decrease of 2, where people with lower loneliness score, so when we did it was 7, the lowest. So between 7 to 9, they actually had, on average, a loneliness increase. So, I mean, it kind of helps us seeing what good looks like. Actually, when you look at older people with a relatively low level of loneliness, unchanged can be a positive outcome if it doesn't change. But I mean, that's all questions that need to be looked at. And also what we realized is that we were, as Sophie said, we have a lot of very high and complex people. So we try to use that as, and use the whole program as a testing field. So we are currently trying to test a case manager a role to work with these higher and complex cases to see, oh, could actually a case manager be better than a volunteer for these people? So these are the ways we try to use this data that we have, but I'm sure people from the audience might have other views, and looking forward to hear that from you. So thank you. I'm going to pass to David now.
Yeah, David.
I'm going to talk about loneliness and costing and sort of the economic issues. And I think here it's going to link to what we've heard about in Reconnections, in the sense that for Reconnections, we are actually collecting some data on impacts on health service use. And we will be able to say something about changes over time in the use of health services. Now, the challenge, of course, with a lot of the empirical work that we're doing is that it takes time. And the policy context at the moment is really very challenging. We know all the issues about the health service. We know about delayed discharge from hospital. We know about the pressures on social care systems. Now, the question is, are the things that economists can at all contribute to this policy challenge at the moment in terms of saying something about the potential economic benefits of tackling loneliness, if loneliness in turn is a risk factor for hospitalisation, for use of social care services, etc. So is there something we can say? Well, I think we can actually say something. And the first thing is to absolutely have massive caveats. Everything I talk about with models, there are huge amounts of assumptions. They're very crude. They have a very limited, in a sense, connection with reality in many ways, which sounds like a strange thing to say. But then I'm going to say, the next thing I'm going to say is that these are absolutely used. These approaches are used in so many areas of decision making, actually not just within health, but also within public policy making more generally. Models are created looking at the potential benefits, the costs, the outcomes associated with all sorts of things. I won't mention about Brexit and models predicting doom and gloom and all that kind of stuff, and economists and all that. But anyway, but the general point is these kinds of models are used a lot, and they are building essentially scenarios. So we're looking at different scenarios around, well, what happens if you have a 1% reduction in loneliness? And these things then happen. What happens if you engage with more people? What happens if you can target more effectively those with the more severe severe end of the spectrum in terms of loneliness? So really, what we're trying to do is to draw, we've created the model at the moment, and we're trying to change that and refine that all the time with more insights, both from work from Reconnections in terms of how people engage or don't engage and where they're coming from, and also sort of a wider literature as well to refine that in terms of the model itself, and then try and produce something that at least is, could be a starting point for a discussion with commissioners. And actually, one of the challenges we have as in the economics world, and I should say my colleague Ella Park is sitting over there, who's worked on this with me. Just wave your hand, Ella. Hi. One of the challenges actually we sometimes find as well is who actually are the commissioners. I mean, in general here we are talking, I suppose, about local authorities, local government, the NHS, but are we also actually trying to engage with Age UK, with other potential service providers, the lottery? Are we talking about engaging with large NGOs? Are we talking about engaging with other sectors of society that can make a difference? So, I don't know, the world of sport or the world of work, actually, in a sense, in terms of the different environments, different commissioners. So not necessarily commissioning a service per se, but funders or interested stakeholders. And then models can say something about that, because they can dissect, well, how much of this is going to be funded by which source, and what difference it makes, and also who pays and who benefits. And again, I'm sure probably everyone in this room will be aware of the absolute frustrating challenge of maybe the health sector pays, but it's the local authority that benefits, or those kinds of problems, fragmented funding, fragmented benefits. So what we can do with models as well is identify not only who pays, but who then will ultimately benefit in terms of any kind of reduction in the need for health or other services over time. So what we've been doing really is trying to produce a model which is gender specific, that can look at populations either by local authority area level or by clinical commissioning group level. We've tried to be very conservative in our assumptions about evidence of impact of effect and indeed on cost, because our model will be wrong. As I said, it's going to be an approximation, and it will absolutely be wrong. And in our view, and that's the same for all models, but in our view, it's better to be conservative and be wrong in terms of underestimating the benefits than the other way around. So that's what we always try and do. We try and use as much as possible as many sources that are as close to an English context as possible. And I say that because some of the data we've had to use in the model is not English data, it's, for instance, Dutch data, because there's quite a few longitudinal studies in Holland that you can use to look at some of the long-term consequences of loneliness. And in our judgment, Holland is reasonably close to the UK in terms of its culture. I mean, I hope there's no Dutch people in the room, they're going to contradict me. But it's reasonably close to the UK in terms of culture, our welfare structure, those kinds of things. But of course, it's not the same as the UK. So that's what we're trying to do. Another thing we haven't actually done yet, but we will try and do, but it's actually more challenging to do than to actually say, is to identify what is a genuine cash saving. Are there any opportunities for actually freeing up money to the NHS, to local authorities, rather than freeing up resources? So a freeing up resources example would be maybe reducing the demands in terms of GP appointments. The GP will still be there, you know, seeing people. You're not going to save money in that sense, but you are going to free up more time or have a reduction in pressure on GP surgeries. But there may be opportunities to absolutely avoid costs because you avoid some health problem that would otherwise have occurred, and therefore there are some costs that are avoided to the NHS in terms of paying for drugs or paying for medical treatment for individuals. So, model development, really. What we're trying to do is we're saying, okay, what we want to do is look at some of the costs over a time period, and we're taking a 10-year time period. Are there benefits, if you can, today, identify and prevent or reduce loneliness in a cohort of individuals? And at the moment, our model assumes that we don't know anything about loneliness prior to contact. So it's a cohort of individuals, and we try and estimate the time spent in lonely states. And really what we've done here, and I don't want to go into the complexities of this today really, but we're really focusing very much on those with severe levels of loneliness rather than moderate loneliness or low loneliness. And we're trying to look and see, well, what does this mean if you're in a severe state of loneliness? What does the literature say about potential long-term and indeed short-term impacts on the use of health services, for example? And what we do here, this is an excerpt of a decision tree model, and it's essentially just telling a story. It's scenarios. You go from this particular model, you go from, well, do you invest in a loneliness intervention or not? You either do your usual activities or you invest, and if you invest, there's a probability that you're either not lonely at the start, you're sometimes lonely, you're always lonely, you could also die at some point in time. We take account of that, sadly. And we also take account of the possible conversion to dementia. And now, one area potentially where there could be an economic and indeed a wider case to be made for tackling loneliness if you do think there's a correlation between severe loneliness and increased risk of dementia, or dementia that requires institutionalisation and high levels of care. There's some evidence suggesting that's the case, but I'm not an expert on that. I'm just saying that if there is more evidence that suggests there is a link between loneliness and dementia, then there's quite a substantial potential opportunity to make an economic case there if, by reducing loneliness, you can genuinely delay or even avoid some cases of dementia. Okay? Now, we did a rapid literature review. I should say this is a paper that's under review at the moment. We did a rapid literature review. We identified a number of papers. And actually, one initial take-home point from the work that we've done so far is, there are lots of people working in health economics and looking at the cost of this, the cost of that. But actually, in terms of the cost of loneliness, it's a relatively modest literature. It's not been looked at or discussed in great depth. And perhaps because, of course, loneliness itself isn't a health condition, it's not a health problem, But I'm still surprised that there hasn't been more research looking at the loneliness as a risk factor for health conditions and costing that. There is a literature there, but there's not that much. And happily in our case, because there is some UK evidence, but the evidence that's out there tends to come from reasonably comparable high-income countries, European countries, North America, Australasia, those kinds of places. So reasonably easy to transfer to a UK context. Now, there are a range of things that in an economic model we might be interested in trying to say something in a sense. Can we, for instance, cost the impact of a reduction in loneliness in terms of contacts with A&E departments, contacts in terms of hospital admissions? Can we say something about GP consultations? Can we say something about the risks of self-harm or suicidal events? What can we say about the impacts in terms of mental health services and physical issues such as coronary heart disease or strokes? Are there things that we can plausibly say about the links between loneliness and those health outcomes and therefore attach a cost or an avoidance of cost to some of those things? Well, we can for some areas, but the evidence here, and I know there'll be people in this room who know this better than me, there'll be sources of data that we can pull more out from to actually try and strengthen what we're saying. But one thing, for instance, we wanted to look at is GP contacts. And I mean, things may have changed now with the new fingertips, well, PH, Public Health England fingertips database and other databases, but the last thing we could find at national level in terms of contacts with GPs at national level goes back to 2009. Which shows the number of GP contacts for individuals over the life course. And what you will note from that is essentially there's rather an explosion, unsurprisingly, in the number of contacts when you get above the age of 60, 65, for both men and women. So we know we have a baseline, we have some baseline data in terms of GP contacts, and there are studies that suggest that there are higher rates of contact for people who are severely lonely. So we're able to put into a model assumptions around the increased rate of contact with GP surgeries for people who are severely lonely. Now, you can challenge that figure, that ratio, which is about 1.8 times the rate we've used in the model. It's actually quite an old estimate from Scotland, the actual the number itself. So it's absolutely contestable. But the point is, I guess a broader point is that in a model, you can change that value to whatever value is appropriate. Okay? So if you think it should be higher or lower, that can be changed, and you can see the impact it has on overall economic costs and savings. And again, another area where, you know, as I say, is there a sufficient evidence base to say that actually, if you can avoid loneliness, can you delay or avoid some cases of dementia entirely? And again, the jury may be out on the strength of that, but there is an evidence base suggesting that there is a link. And some of this is Dutch data, some of this are meta-analysis from a number of studies all over the world, but they do suggest having social contacts, having a more active mind, and indeed actually not being isolated socially can actually reduce, but then it may actually reduce some of the risks of dementia. So you can see in this example here, the Dutch study from Amstel, the Amstel region of Amsterdam. What they found there is that feelings of loneliness, it's a relatively large sample, 2,000 individuals followed up over quite a long time period. It's about 1.6 times greater than what you'd expect to see in the general population. Now, the question is how, you know, is that plausible? Is that, you know, how robust is that estimate? That's something that has to be debated further, but you can point to a number of cases. Again, another 19 studies in this review by Kuiper and colleagues suggesting a risk about 1.5 times greater for people with, in terms of dementia and loneliness. And again, so we can plug that into our model and look at the potential in terms of avoiding some of the costs associated with dementia. And you can say, well, actually, this is nonsense in terms of the number, but we can change the probabilities. We can change the relative risk, in a sense, of having dementia if you are lonely. And we have good data from actually colleagues of ours at the LSE about University of Cambridge and Newcastle and other places around the increased risks of dementia over age, of course. We have all that there, so we can use that. We can also use data that's already out there in terms of the costs of managing dementia, both to the health system, to the social care system, and to families, depending on the severity of the dementia. So we can take account of that in our modelling analysis. Okay, so we can say there's an increased, if you believe there's a link between loneliness and dementia, we can then look at that increased risk and then look at the potential long-term costs of that. And well, we'll come back to what difference that makes to the overall model in a minute, but there is also, there was a recent review by a meta-analysis by Nicole Valtorta and colleagues at the University of York. And they were looking at the links between depression, stroke, and coronary heart disease, and loneliness. And what they found there is that there are associations: an increased risk of 29% for heart disease and 32% for strokes. So small, but nonetheless significant increased risk. And again, we can include costs of that into a model. So cost to the healthcare system of managing, in our case, the very mild levels of coronary heart disease. That's all we've done, very mild levels, and the costs of strokes as well. We can also include in the model we have some of the increased costs of depression, and we've got quite good data on that. But we also adjust for the fact that most people with depression never come into contact with health services. Only around a third of people who would benefit from health service contact for depression actually use services, so we assume that's the case in our model as well. One in six, actually, because it's older contacts. Now, maybe there's something we can say about suicide. Now, the danger with this particular slide, this shows an increased risk of self-harm and suicidal events in individuals who are lonely from the previous psychiatric morbidity survey from 2007. So it's cross-sectional data, so it's a two-week survey, I think. A very small number of people, suggesting the risks, I think, were up to 17 times greater, I think it was. Maybe I've got the numbers wrong now, but it was 17.37 times greater for a self-harm event if you're severely lonely compared to somebody who's not. But it's a very small sample. Again, is there a stronger evidence base out there about the links between self-harm and loneliness to actually talk about that further? But we have included it in the model at the moment, that estimate as well. So we look there, for instance, and very conservatively, what does this mean in terms of contacts with A&E departments? We know a certain proportion of people who self-harm go to the hospital A&E departments. So we've made an assumption around that. And we've also assumed that if they go to the A&E department and they're identified as being having suicidal ideation, they will have what's called a psychosocial assessment, which is recommended by NICE as a standard care pathway. But we don't say anything at all about the cost of treating self-harm. Just the assessments and the initial contact with A&E. Okay, so we're trying to be conservative there, and also conservative in terms of the number of people who turn up in the first place. But it's based on cross-sectional data from a two-week study in 2007. And I couldn't find this immediately in the update, the 2014 survey of this data. And the raw data set for that survey is not available yet. But what we're trying to say in the model itself is that there are substantive costs associated with loneliness. I think there's a massive question about precisely what those costs are and precisely what the best estimates are. But I think we can all agree in this room there are costs, and there are costs in terms of your health status and indeed other factors as well. Now, running that model, what we come up with, this is a very, very crude analysis, but essentially most of the potential costs that are avoidable seem to be, and this is over a 10-year period, for people who can, through contact with a service, avoid becoming severely lonely constantly over that 10-year period, okay? Most of the savings are really in terms of the avoidance of hospital admissions, okay? And that's because we do have some data on the increased risk of hospital admission for individuals who are lonely. Now, again, there's all sorts of issues there about confounding factors and causality and other things that we've heard about earlier. But nonetheless, at the moment, that's potentially the area that would have that appears to be the largest single contributor to the overall costs for an individual. And this, if this is indeed anywhere near the actual observed reality, then you're talking about significant policy relevance of this issue at the moment, because hospital admissions are such an important issue, or certainly hospital discharges. But you can't be discharged if you haven't been admitted, so avoiding admittance is a good thing. But issues such as stroke and coronary heart disease don't have a major impact here, but that's probably because we've been very conservative. So for instance, with the heart disease, we've just assumed it's the cost of managing heart disease with drugs, and they literally are just a few pence or something. They're very, very small charges now for some of the generic drugs for managing heart disease, the basic drugs. But you will see there are costs for dementia in terms of social care costs and costs to families, informal family care, that's associated with this increased risk of dementia that we believe is plausible, that's linked to loneliness. And then small costs as well, but not insignificant, 16% of the additional costs in terms of GP consultations, extra GP consultations. But again, the question there is how can we get better data? And we're collecting it hopefully through reconnections. We'll have some more data from that sample, but more data more generally on the level of GP consultations and contacts by people who are severely lonely. In our analysis, you may remember, just I've done lots and lots of things and sort of bamboozled you probably with lots of numbers and so forth, but at the very beginning I said that we made no assumptions about whether or not, what sort of level of loneliness individuals had. If you rerun the model that we've done, but you assume that you can absolutely reach those people who genuinely are severely lonely and target your intervention, then the potential savings you can avoid actually per individual over a 10-year period rise to more like £6,000 compared to £1,700, because you can be more, you're reaching those people who can benefit most, essentially. And you're not having to spend resources, dealing is the wrong word, but looking at less severe issues of loneliness. Now, of course, there may be costs associated with less severe issues of loneliness, don't get me wrong, but in our model, we've tried to assume that most of those costs are for the severely lonely alone and no one else, because we didn't have strong enough evidence on lower levels of loneliness. But the question there is, can it be targeted? Are there ways of targeting it? For instance, the approach that's been used that we've heard from Age UK in Hereford and Worcestershire and social finance and so forth, that approach to try and target, identify people through a telephone instruments, and then identify those that are above a certain cutoff point on the UCLA. Is that an effective way to try and target things more than, for instance, other approaches where people turn up at a navigator or a service in a town and then are referred on? And now, I'd be very cautious about the number we have down there below, but we extrapolated this the entire population of everyone between the age of 60 and 70, essentially, by strange coincidence in Worcestershire. And you do get some very large numbers there in terms of savings. I mean, those savings will probably be an awful lot less than that. And how much of that is cashable is another question mark. But nonetheless, it's a starting point for thinking about the potential resource impacts, both to the health service and to local authorities in a local area, as well as thinking about these things at a national level as well. But the other final thing is that with models, and I've already said there are lots of caveats about the model itself, you can criticise it heavily, I'm sure you can, you definitely can, but then again, models are always like that, and models are used in policy making, so it's really about refining and trying to make them as good as we can, or to make the assumptions as good as we can. But in any case, the other thing fundamentally, and we can build this into modelling as well, but it's also about implementation of any intervention to tackle loneliness. First of all, we need to know they work. They have to be effective. Let's not forget that rather important point. But then also, you may have a fantastic loneliness intervention, but if no one actually uses it, then it's a complete waste of time as well. So there are issues there about what works, also about how to engage. And I think there's so much valuable information, again, we just heard about how to adapt an intervention to try and reach more people, to try and engage with more and ensure there are better longer-term follow-up or pathways of support, I suppose, for individuals. So looking at what works, but taking into account also in a model of what is effective in engaging and continued engagement, and seeing what difference that makes to our overall estimates of costs as well. And that really is where we are. What I would stress is that economists can't work in isolation. We have to work with topic experts, and we have to also know what's actually happening on the ground in terms of how active... Who's interested in this? Does it actually work? Do people use these services? We had the issue earlier about in reconnections, it's 70% women mainly who use this. Are there more things we could do to reach men? who still make up a fairly high proportion of the older population. May not be 50%, but it's high. And so thinking about things like that as well. But there are insights we can take from both that study and other studies as well. There is an international literature and a UK literature out there, but what can we do to strengthen that, to have more robust, defensible estimates about potential relative risks of poorer health outcomes and indeed social care outcomes linked to loneliness? And indeed, then also building into that different types of options in terms of costs and cost effectiveness of interventions. So it might be about a befriending service compared to a more intensive, there could be different levels of intensity of befriending. It could be about the duration of the intervention. It could be about a self-referred navigator service or something that's much more active in trying to identify individuals. All sorts of things there to think about, and also thinking about different models of who pays. Because also, I suspect with some of these low-level services, they'll be self-funded. People will self-fund themselves to go along to a community group and so forth, and thinking about that in the model as well. So I hope that's helpful, and I hope you can see the link between actually what's going on in terms of evaluating practice, and indeed the link before in the first session about the challenges in measurement, and also the challenges, I think, in selling the evidence space, and I use that term advisedly, selling, to whoever you're trying to reach with the money. Are they going to be convinced it's worth doing, given that there's so many pressures on health system and social care budgets at the moment? Thanks.
Thank you.
And I think that's all that's done. Yeah.